Bonsoir à tous, bienvenue sur le plateau Equinox Soir, votre décryptage quotidien de l'actualité. De lundi à vendredi, 19h, 21h, 18h, 20h, Greenwich Mean Time. Et si c'était le Saint-Siège qui détenait la clé de la résolution du conflit dans les régions nord-ouest, région anglophone du Cameroun, beaucoup seraient tentés de l'affirmer au regard des derniers développements liés à cette crise déclenchée en 2016. En la faveur de l'audience accordée vendredi dernier par le président de la République au secrétaire d'État du Saint-Siège, et surtout après la messe célébrée hier dimanche pour la paix dans les deux régions anglophones en crise. Dans son homélie, le numéro 2 du Vatican, qui souhaite un retour à la paix, a appelé au dialogue afin de résoudre cette crise qui perdure. Cette volonté affichée par le représentant du Saint-Siège d'aller vers la paix avait déjà été exprimée par l'Église catholique locale. Malheureusement, affirme Mgr Abraham Comin, président de la Conférence épiscopale nationale du Cameroun, la demande des évêques du Cameroun de rencontrer le président de la République afin de discuter et envisager des pistes de sortie de crise est jusqu'ici restée lettre morte. Madame, Monsieur, tout à l'heure à 20h, c'est la grande édition d'informations présentée par Cédric Noufélé, tout de suite après le débrief du journal et tout de suite le fait du jour. Crise dans le nord-ouest et le sud-ouest, l'Église catholique peut-elle réussir ou les autres ont échoué? Pour en parler, nous avons invité en plateau ce soir Prince Joël Mokage. Good evening. Welcome.
Good evening to you, Serge Alain. Good evening to my co-panelists. Good evening to those watching in the Northwest and the Southwest region. Special good evening to the peace-loving people of Misaje Subdivision.
Okay. Good evening, Dr. Makantoni Akumbo.
Thank you. Good evening, Serge, and to my fellow panelists, to the people of Cameroon, precisely to those of the Northwest and Southwest, and to my beloved family, I think, watching me right now.
Barrister Kamaliman, you're welcome.
Thank you once more, Mr. Sesh, and good evening to my co-panelists. I want to tell you that every time I'm called on this subject, I rarely come because it is something that I think we should always talk until we reach such a point that we have a solution to stop this crisis in Northwest and Southwest.
Voilà, Kamon Liman, je rappelle, vous êtes PhD researcher, yes, English law. Mm. You're welcome.
Thank
je
you
commence
so much.
Avec vous, Barrister Kamon Liman. L'Église catholique qui veut, on va le dire comme ça, s'impliquer une fois de plus pour la résolution de cette crise. Qu'est-ce qui peut vous amener à penser que cette fois-ci peut être la bonne?
Monsieur Alain, je commence d'abord à remercier même le Seigneur pour avoir donné cette désir de l'Église de venir parler de nos problèmes ici au Cameroun. Et comme vous avez bien dit, ça a tant duré. Oui. Et je crois, je suis toujours optimiste, je crois que avec le temps, les partis ont constaté que la guerre ne résout pas de problème. Donc je crois que l'État camerounais a dû constater aussi qu'ils ont gaspillé énormément de ressources pour presque rien. Parce que jusqu'à nos jours, cette guerre persiste. Et de l'autre côté aussi, je pense que des gens qui ont pris les armes doivent comprendre que ce n'est pas ce qu'il faut, parce que en réalité, des personnes qui souffrent maintenant, c'est des anglophones qui recherchaient la population, qui recherchaient une vie meilleure. Donc, je crois que c'est un plus. L'Église est venue ajouter, n'est-ce pas, parmi des autres personnes qui ont estimé qu'un dialogue peut vraiment résoudre le crise anglophone. Et il faut rappeler aussi que même des chefs de village de l'Ouest avaient aussi entamé ces procédures. Mmh. Et je regrette que chaque fois quand des personnes viennent avec cette idée-là, apparemment ça offense certaines personnes. Mmh. parce que je ne sais pas comment l'État pourrait ignorer l'appel qui a été fait par des chefs de l'Ouest jusqu'au point qu'on stigmatise certaines de ces personnes. L'Église, vous avez bien dit qu'il y a des archevêques qui ont demandé de voir le chef de l'État. Et jusqu'à aujourd'hui, ils ne sont pas encore reçus par le chef de l'État. J'ai dit, c'est un mépris.
Est-ce qu'on peut conclure tout de suite que le président ne veut pas recevoir l'Église ?
D'abord, c'est un mépris envers ces gens-là qui sont là pour nous guider spirituellement. Le chef de l'État n'est pas au-dessus de Dieu. Et je sais qu'il est un catholique, catholique fervent. Et que tout le monde doit contribuer, n'est-ce pas, pour que la paix soit restaurée dans les zones anglophones. Donc, à mon avis, le pape a constaté que peut-être on n'a pas pris des évêques camerounais au sérieux et que quelqu'un de cette valeur devrait venir. J'ai m'associé avec lui pour demander que vraiment, il faut que la paix soit de retour au nord-ouest et au sud-ouest.
Voilà, on ne va pas terminer le tour, hein, parce qu'il y a un invité qui n'est pas encore là. Mais on va d'abord prendre la direction de Paris où nous attend Abdelaziz. Bonsoir Abdelaziz, bienvenue une fois de plus. Oui, Abdelaziz, on vous a pas suivi. Bonsoir. Bon, voilà, voilà. Justement, on va camper sur cet aspect. Les évêques du Cameroun qui demandent à être reçus. Pas de réponse. Mais le représentant du pape qui vient au Cameroun est reçu. Est-ce qu'il faut voir la chose comme ça?
Cameroun has a very long history of, let me say this, disrespect for the church. And apart from that, the church in itself, I mean the Roman Catholic Church, has an internal problem that has permitted them to be disrespected. Okay. I'm going to speak
Donc vous dites que en interne d'abord, il y a des problèmes.
I'm going to speak
dans
from those two directions to give you reasons why the church is being disrespected and why we are where we are, where the church, I think that if it needs to stand as an arbiter towards this particular crisis, what it will need to do to become a better arbiter. The first thing is, I will remind you back history. When the UPC had an uprising, which was actually hitting Cameroon, in the 70s, before the 70s even, but in the 70s, I remember the president, Ahijo Biden, told Ndomo to intervene, to stop with, yes, to speak with the leaders of the UPC.
And that's one thing.
And later on, he was accused for supporting the UPC. And he was arrested, later on condemned to death. In fact, that was his penalty. And yes, and that resulted to so much talking from within the church. It all happened that the bishops of the church sat down, wrote to the presidency denouncing such stuff. He was sentenced to life imprisonment, and in 1975 he was released. When he was released, there is something that happened which shows the division that is within the Catholic Church. Why other bishops were celebrating, the Bishop of Yaoundé, Jean Zoua, the Archbishop of Yaoundé by then, refused celebrating along with them. That was the first. Why? He was somebody who was connected to the regime in place by then. He was in favor. When we come to the 1980s, there is something that also happened where a group of Bassa bishops in the littoral wrote to the bishop, to the Pope, because of the fact that a lot of Bamley case were being nominated to positions which were not in the Bamley Kela. And they wrote and sent a memorandum to the Pope condemning that. That's division. There were popes of Bassa origin were against the fact that the bishops were being raised from other areas. Apart from that, it all happened that during that same period, rounding up that year, that decade, the present Cardinal Tumi was nominated by the Pope to become the bishop of Marwa.
Garwa.
I beg your pardon, of Garwa, which is in the north. The people, this is the terminology these people use. They said he is an Anglophone Bamlike, still an appointee, which is related to the grassroots, which is contrary to what they want. That's division. Then in the 1990s, when the multi-partism was being set up, look at what happened. The day SDF was being launched in Bamenda, 6 persons who were supporters of the party were killed. And when they were killed, in Bamenda, the Archbishop of Bamenda, Paul, had to organize a prayer for them, a mass for them. What was the response of the bishop, the Archbishop of Yaoundé? The Archbishop of Yaoundé organized a contrary mass,
yeah,
saying that they need to cleanse those kind of masses that are taking place in the Catholic Church. Those are reasons why, necessarily, if you are a leader who is objective and want to see progress, you will not expect that the church that should be an example should be tribalistic. But the church in Cameroon has shown the leaders of this nation that they are tribalistic and they can work based on their gains. And that is enough reason why some of them are disrespected. Of recent.
Mais ça, c'est quand même la voix du président là. C'est la conférence épiscopale nationale.
You see, I am speaking from this point because I want you to see that there is something wrong.
Yeah.
That is causing the church not to gain respect before politicians in Cameroon. They have taken the lower bar. And as a result of that, it is affecting them. When you come to the other side, I want to say this. If the church will become a better arbiter, it is supposed to take a neutral ground. It is supposed to take a neutral ground and show that to the politicians in this nation that they are neutral. And when that happens, I'm certain that they will have a bit, that voice will be heard.
Okay.
If they can come together and speak, it will make a difference.
Okay.
Even though the president of the
Episcopal Conference
has written, it is not something that will just happen. They need to show that sense. Because I will tell you this, even though one person write, because we believe in the Catholic Church that you can't, it is a voice of the bishop that is a voice of the people. So if he spoke, it is good. But if they have not been received, it is because there is something wrong. They have seen division among them. And so they need to come to unity. Unite themselves. Let that divide in the Catholic Church disappear.
Okay.
When it disappears, they will have respect.
Voilà, vous êtes d'accord avec ça? C'est les divisions en interne qui amènent, ce qui conduisent à ce silence de la part des Tutsis. Déjà, Monseigneur André Nkéa, l'archevêque de Bamenda, lui dit, il arrive que les séparatistes nous accusent d'être proches du gouvernement et que le gouvernement nous aussi nous accuse d'être proches des séparatistes.
You know, I understood Prof's standpoint. I believe that he's speaking more as a clergy than he is. It's because he also has a double cap as a man of God. I think that what is ongoing in Cameroon today is not an issue of division within the Catholic Church. First of all, I don't have the power to talk about the Catholic Church because I hold no position within that church to criticize the church. But I believe that what is ongoing...
Attendez une minute. Vous avez suivi ce qui s'est passé dans l'Église catholique après la présidentielle?
We know what is
entre
happening.
M. Cléda Douala et Jean Baga Yaoundé.
We know what is happening, Serge. Voilà. And it is in all churches. It's not different. The EEC has the same. The Presbyterian has the same.
We are not,
in all churches,
we are
it's
not
the same thing.
But
I think that what is peculiar today is the fact that we have a personality from the Catholic Church that can turn the tables around. Oui. That is the major thing. Because, Serge, we should take it or leave it. The Catholic Church remains a state within a state. And the personality who is in Cameroon, there are two things that caught my attention about his visit. The first thing is that for the first time, we saw a Secretary of State, Minister Delegate, Secretary at the Presidency, oui. Ferdinand Gongo. You saw him in Bamenda.
Yes.
That is somebody that we've always seen him during communiques. The President, he's only communiques. And for the first time, you see him in Bamenda. And if you see him in Bamenda, it tells you that it is serious business. It's not any kind of business. And secondly, while during his stay in Bamenda, he made it very clear that violence has never solved any problem. It means that it's a message to the government in Yaoundé that if you think that you can use weapons to kill the struggle, then it's not the right way, because violence cannot solve the problem. And if you go by what Archbishop Kia said, that when you talk this way, they feel you're for government, you talk this way, they feel he is just one of those so many Cameroonians. When Prince come on platforms like this and talk about, no, the government went wrong here. What they attack you is that you are a separatist. The day you say, okay, the government did well, then you are with the government. So at times within the crisis today, Serge, it becomes very difficult to be objective, because objectivity within the crisis today, either you're attacked being an amber or you're attacked being with the government. But there is one thing that is very clear, that the personality who is in Cameroon today, Cardinal Pedro Parolin, it's not any kind of person.
Oui.
I believe that somebody within the Catholic Church who is already signaling is going to dive into that. The personality we have in Cameroon today, who are 6 days, is the Secretary of State of the Vatican City.
Oui. And numéro deux du Vatican.
And so she goes to tell you that it's not any kind of personality who is in Cameroon. The moment he's in Cameroon, he has a tête-à-tête with Paul Biya. It is true that during his stay, information wasn't given that much about what he discussed with the Yaoundé regime, but it is clear that the Anglophone crisis was top on agenda. And secondly, while in Bamenda, you will notice that during the mass that he held in Bamenda, everything that he preached during the installation, during Bishop Kia's ordination at the podium, you will notice that everything that Cardinal Parolin said had to do with the crisis. And Serge, if those who are following us and know what the program Equinoxua is and what some of us have said here, it's not different from what we have been saying. He talked about a ceasefire, he talked about justice, he talked about truth. Because we have a crisis today because there is the absence of truth inside. When a minister goes to Bamenda, for instance, and tells you that Biya has won the war against separatists, when in real sense, people are still in the bushes, it's lies telling. And when you tell lies, a crisis cannot be solved. You cannot solve a crisis when people still carry arms. That's why it talks about ceasefire. And you cannot solve a crisis when there is no justice. So I believe that what is ongoing today, Serge, the Catholic Church is the universal church. It's a church that is all over. The Catholic Church is in Cameroon, and I still feel that there is a possibility for Cardinal Pedro Parolin to push the tables around. And I know that if the Catholic Church, as it has taken it as a responsibility, if they want that the Anglophone crisis should end, they can force it down the throat of Paul Biya. Why? Because the president is a member of that church. Remember that, like Prof was saying, during history, it is very true that Ahidjo did not have a good relationship with the Vatican. That is why the first ever pope to come to Cameroon only came during the Biya's regime. No pope came during the Ahidjo's regime, maybe because of Alben Domo. We should not forget that Bishop Alben Domo was at the verge of being killed. But the Pope said, I heard you have a certain Cameroonian called Alben Domo.
Oui.
You can go ahead and kill that your Cameroonian, but do not touch my bishop.
Oui,
But what happened, Serge? We know that amongst those that were to be executed, he was not executed. It means that today, if the Catholic Church is of good faith, the Anglophone crisis we are seeing every day is turning. And we are those Cameroonians who've said it here since 2016, that the system that the government is taking cannot solve the Anglophone crisis. The Cardinal Pedro said that Pope in Rome is aware of the crisis in Cameroon that it is 4 years. It is time, Serge Alain Oudou, that the Catholic Church forced the regime in Yaoundé. Ferdinand Gongo was in Bamenda. It is very true that when a majority of them go to Bamenda, they end within upstation and Ayaba Hotel where they do reception. A majority of them do not know where Mfuma is located, they don't know where Akwa is located, they don't know where those villages are. And I would have loved, I was discussing with somebody today when you sent me this topic, I told somebody that if Ferdinand Gongo could move from Bamenda to Nkambe without escortion, without the military, and he goes back to Yaoundé, then I'll sit on this platform and say the Anglophone crisis is over.
Okay. Augustin Wendou, welcome.
Thank you very much, Serge.
Voilà, Augustin, nous parlons de l'Église et des divisions à l'intérieur de l'Église avec la présence du secrétaire d'État du Saint-Siège qui est au Cameroun. Le président l'a reçu, mais Monseigneur Abraham Comin dit que l'Église catholique, le clergé, a émis le vœu d'être reçu par le président Biya. Toujours rien. Certains pensent que c'est du fait des divisions internes à l'Église. Pourquoi le clergé camerounais n'est pas, on va le dire comme ça, écouté par le président? Pourquoi quand c'est quelqu'un qui vient du Vatican, il est reçu tout de suite? Qu'est-ce qui se passe?
I want to, first and foremost,
pourtant, le clergé camerounais propose, comme ils disent, une sortie de crise aussi, des pistes pour sortir de la crise.
I want to, first of all, greet my co-panelist, of course, my senior brother there, and of course, my brothers who are around the table here, and to greet televiewers, and to greet the people of the Northwest and the Southwest region, and the people of Cameroon as a whole. The question you asked me, I want to first and foremost say the Catholic Church is universal. There is no division within the Catholic Church. Because if you want to talk about division within the Catholic Church
in Cameroon,
then you are telling me that there is a rebel a bishop that has broken apart and has formed another church. But no, in as much as nothing of that sort is happening, I want to be very crystal clear that no division within the church. Why is the church not listened to? I believe that you should ask this question to the powers that be. Because I, on this panel, I state it unequivocal that when the bishop, the archbishop of Abuja, wants to see Muhammadu Buhari, the president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, he merely picked his call. He merely picked his phone and made a call. And he's at the Rock House. Okay? Why is it different in Cameroon? Why is it different? We have a cardinal in Cameroon that had governed Cameroon, Equatorial Guinea, Chad, and the Central African Republic.
Augustin, vous prenez un cas, le président Buhari est musulman, et vous dites que on veut l'appeler. Au Cameroun, le président est catholique et les. L'Église catholique, pourquoi ça ne passe pas?
I don't want to take it from the perspective of the president being a Catholic. Whether a Muslim, whether an animist, whether a non-Christian, I want to say that the church is a moral institution. And the Catholic Church in international diplomacy cannot be overemphasized. The level at which the Catholic Church has lifted this country, if you want to talk in educational domain, in health domain, even in spiritual domain, I don't see how it's possible that, I mean, the president of the National Episcopal Conference is not received by the head of state. It's repugnant to me, and I'm at a loss that as of this moment, His Eminence Christian Cardinal to me, with all the effort he put in place, I believe that he would have been received at the State House severally. In order, because I want to tell you, look, my prince was just saying here, politicians cannot freely go to the Northwest and the Southwest region. Cabinet ministers alike
If they want to go, they put on gun proofs and go with military convoy. But the only person who can freely go, and you can, I stand corrected, is a pastor. He's a man of God. And that is why His Eminence, Cardinal Brito Parolin, fell free in Bamenda. You saw the crowd. He was not like talking in a war torn town. He said, this is promised land. This is a land blessed by God, in spite of the turmoil. That is to tell you that the church knows how to talk. The church know better how to communicate and what to communicate and to which audience, all right? Meaning that if this crisis from escalation, if the church has been given the opportunity, the church would have spoken in the language that the people will understand. The church would have spoken wisdom, spoken spiritually, and spoken even socially. Because the church is an embodiment of humanity. Okay? But I have the impression that the church has never been given the opportunity to speak, to act.
Okay. Voilà.
That is why I am still saying, because if you go by the number of pastoral letters written by the National Episcopal Conference of Cameroon, if you go even by individual action like that of the Archbishop Emeritus, His Eminent Christian Cardinal Toumi. Remember that the Archbishop of Douala, His Grace Samuel Kleda, drove from here, Douala, right to the Federal Republic of Nigeria, accompanied by other bishops like His Grace Andrew Kea. He was then the Bishop of Mafi. He was equally accompanied by Monsignor Abraham Kome, who is the National Episcopal Conference president. He was equally accompanied by by Monsignor Bibi Michael Miabise, who is now the Bishop of Boya. They went to the Federal Republic of Nigeria. That is to tell you that where politicians cannot enter, where those who carry guns cannot enter, men of God enters. Okay. Because they preach the good news of hope, they preach the good news of peace, they preach the good news of salvation.
Voilà. Barrister,
yes.
On comprend, hein? Il dit que où les politiques ont échoué, l'Église peut faire. Mais comment comprendre donc que, je crois, entre le 5 et le 6 novembre dernier, qu'on est pris comme ça, on est retenu, Monseigneur le Cardinal Toumi. Est-ce que les séparatistes n'avaient pas confiance? Comment prendre quelqu'un, un homme de Dieu?
Serge, I'll start by honestly disassociating myself with the presumption that the church is so divided, and that's the reason of not being received by the head of state. Yes, the church, there is no justification. There is no justification why the president of the republic will not receive the men of God. You understand? And I want to make it clear
le caractère laïque du Cameroun.
No, Serge, it is state arrogance.
Oui.
The president has exhibited arrogance, his pride and arrogance that can lead to such behaviors. Because the clergymen.
Est-ce que le président a dit non qu'il ne les reçoit pas?
Pour dire non, ce n'est pas absolument pour dire.
Est-ce qu'il n'a pas encore répondu?
Mais s'il y a un problème qui persiste,
oui.
Et on demande de vous voir et vous ne voyez pas les gens, ce n'est pas un refus, c'est un refus. Donc le problème est vraiment. Des massacres sont énormes que même si c'est le matin qu'on appelle le président de la République, il doit recevoir des gens le soir. Donc ce n'est aucune justification. Pour moi, c'est une affaire d'arrogance, de mépris. L'Église n'est pas aussi divisée comme on nous fait croire. Non, c'est l'État qui ne veut pas comprendre. Et c'est la même chose avec des chefs du village. On ne va pas dire qu'il n'y a pas l'harmonie entre les chefs, c'est pour cela qu'on ne les écoute pas. Non, on ne les écoute pas parce que nous vivons dans un pays qui ne respecte rien. dans un pays que le chef de l'État est là depuis longtemps et sûrement il se confonde être peut-être le roi. Vous comprenez, voilà des vérités que des Camerounais, nous tous, on connaît, que beaucoup de personnes ont peur de les dire. Mais ça, ce sont des vérités. Quand vous laissez quelqu'un, n'est-ce pas, comme président pendant 40 ans, vous pensez à quoi? Vous pensez à quoi? Donc, tout cela sont des manifestations, n'est-ce pas, de cette longévité. Et n'oublie pas que même le Christ anglophone est la conséquence de ce comportement. Quand des problèmes ont commencé, on ne voulait pas régler. Il y a des gens qui ont fait des efforts. Quand ici, Cardinal Toumi a été arrêté ou kidnappé par des ambazonistes, c'est parce qu'on trouve qu'il est en train peut-être de trop faire l'effort à un point que peut-être il croit qu'il est aux côtés de l'État. Ce qui est faux. Nous tous, on a besoin de la paix. Et si quelqu'un... Je vais vous demander quelque chose. Est-ce que c'est normal que c'est un étranger qui doit venir vous dire qu'il faut régler ces problèmes?
Voilà.
Ce n'est pas un étranger qui doit venir. Nous-mêmes, on peut régler ces problèmes. Il faut juste qu'on soit honnête.
Accepter.
Et accepter. Et sèche, j'ai toujours dit, la procédure pour régler cette crise anglophone est très simple. Ça commence avec honnêteté.
C'est clair.
Soyons honnêtes. Il y a un problème.
C'est clair.
Et sèche, on ne peut pas régler le Christ anglophone sans changer la forme de l'État. Voilà la vérité. Des anglophones ont dépassé cette constitution de 96 qui parlait de décentralisation. Nous sommes déjà dépassés, c'est déjà dépassé. Et maintenant, des gens qui ont pris exemple, que je condamne, n'est-ce pas, veulent la sécession. Mais... nous, il y a certains de nous qui croient que le fédéralisme, nous, on veut rester avec de nos frères camerounais. Donc, si le chef de l'État dit aujourd'hui, j'ai compris ce problème, je comprends que on a parlé de cette constitution-là, ça fait 20 quelque chose des années, oui, mais c'est maintenant qu'on essaye, n'est-ce pas, d'appliquer, je sais que ça pose un problème. Regarde. Quand à 96 ils ont pris, modifié cette constitution, ça reflète, n'est-ce pas, l'aspiration de Camerounais à cette époque, qui est différent de l'attente de Camerounais aujourd'hui. Donc, il n'y a aucune justification pour ne pas recevoir quelqu'un qui veut que la paix rentre, n'est-ce pas, au Noso. Il n'y a pas. Et donc, moi, l'appel que j'ai fait, ça va commencer avec honnêteté, humble. Il faut être humble dans la vie.
Il a tout dit.
Regarde, et ça, c'est une qualité. Regarde, je vais vous dire quelque chose. Ça, c'est une qualité que je supplie que beaucoup de Camerounais peuvent développer. Être humble. Quand vous êtes humble, vous pouvez bien gérer des gens. Quand vous êtes humble, vous pouvez écouter et connaître. Je vais vous dire. Il ne faut pas qu'on se pète. Le chef de l'État est à Yaoundé pour régler le problème camerounais. Avant tout. Et pour régler ce problème, il doit écouter. Il doit écouter ce peuple. Est-ce que vous pensez honnêtement que Paul Biya a écouté ses enfants? Est-ce que vous pensez que Paul Biya a suffisamment écouté des chefs de village? Est-ce que vous pensez que le chef de l'État a écouté l'Église? On ne peut pas prétendre que l'Église doit être neutre. Quand quelque chose est mauvais, l'Église est aux côtés de la vérité et aux côtés des personnes, tout le monde, que, n'est-ce pas, qui les suit. L'Église ne va pas dire aujourd'hui que non, il n'y a pas un problème. Non, il y a un problème. Nous tous, on connaît qu'il y a un problème. Il faut qu'on soit honnête, humble et avoir cette volonté pour régler cette... Si les trois choses, pendant quelques jours, si on pratique les trois choses, la crise de Onozo sera oubliée.
Voilà.
Oui, Dr. McAnthony.
Ok.
Vous dites qu'on ne vous a pas bien saisi.
I saw that when I was talking, they were taken by the division, they were not listening to me.
We so listened to you.
No,
I did listen to you.
The first statement I made was that the reason why the Cameroon government lacks is not even permitting to receive our clergy is the fact first. There is a division. What division was I talking about? There is this idea of Anglophone bishops and Francophone bishops. That is the thing you should understand. Yeah. Why I presented, forget about the personality, forget about this. I cited situations where you see the bishop of Yaoundé taking sides with the regime. Not as if when the bishops of Bamenda speak, who are the ones facing the problem, he stands outright against them. When I cited a situation where Cardinal Tumu was nominated by the Pope. It's not a tribal thing. Some bishops of Bassa origin got up here in Douala, wrote to a memorandum to the Pope. That is to tell you that there is a tribal issue, and that has caused something. To my perspective, I look at it as a reason for the disrespect that the state is giving to the church. Because on normal basis, the church is the voice of the state. When I say the voice, I'm speaking from this position because, listen, if I go to settle an issue and meet persons who are having a loggerhead, I don't take a position. The people receive me. But already when the bishops in the Northwest want to speak, they already are having a preconception that these people...
Which is false.
I think it's false. When I say the governing body has a preconception that those people, because they are Anglophones, right, they will speak for the Anglophones. That is a wrong way to perceive them. They should not perceive them from that position. They should perceive them as a neutral body. That is the way the government should perceive the church, as a neutral body. And when the church is perceived as a neutral body, they can stand in a better position to be a good arbiter for this problem. But once they are coming and you already have a preconception that these people, they are Anglophone, irrespective of the fact that they are having that clergy title on them, they have a problem, or the government has a problem already with the fact that they are not Francophones. And so I see a division based on language, which is the same thing that is happening in Cameroon. In Cameroon, we have, I think there are six archbishops, right? You are from Kali Church. There are six of them. One is from the Anglophone section. Okay. And when, yes, one of the archbishops carries the whole Anglophone, right? We call the Bamenda. Ecclesiastical province, when they spoke, I think 2017, they spoke from a position where they understood the crisis better.
Parce qu'ils vivent,
but there was a direct response that was coming from a bishop, an archbishop in Yaoundé. That already has something to do. So when you ask me, Should the government not look at them with that preconception that they are Anglophone, is wrong. They are men of God. Okay. They should be perceived as men of God. And if they are coming to solve a problem, they should be received as men of God. It goes back to all of us here, to on that same point where I said there is disrespect from the government to the church. The government has disrespect for the church. And I was saying that from my own viewpoint, I perceive that might be it is because of that divide. And even if it is not from that divide, it already proves that the church in Cameroon does not, I mean the government of Cameroon does not have good faith when it comes to the church. Because I don't see a reason. We have a cardinal in Cameroon. It is not a cardinal that is leaving from Rome to come and solve the problem when we have a cardinal right in Cameroon. Apart from a cardinal, we have bishops all over Cameroon. What happened in Côte d'Ivoire? Was it the Pope or the Secretary of State of Vatican that came and solved it? No. It was popes from within the Democratic Republic of Congo. Was bishops. If our own bishops attempt to go and handle it and they are disrespected that much, that is to make you understand that we have a government that is not God-fearing in the first place. We have a government that does not think that the church is fit. You see, I tend to believe at times that those who are leading us in Cameroon have already fallen, and their path had already been determined for destruction. And that is why they don't want to listen to the voice of council.
Okay.
And so they are willing to let destruction come to Cameroon even when they are in the presence of light. So that is something that when we are speaking, I am not fighting against the Roman Catholic Church, because that is at sort of the point from which you came. I am not against the Roman Catholic Church. I am from that particular base. So there's no way for me to stand against it. But I'm saying that there is a francophone anglophone divide. Okay. Which, to me, is a problem.
Voilà, on va prendre Blasis Moundé. Je crois que cette fois-ci, c'est la bonne. Blasis Moundé, l'Église catholique, c'est la question. Peut-elle réussir ou les autres ont échoué à Blasis depuis Paris?
Oui, bonsoir. Good evening to all our panelists and our viewers tonight. We are speaking about a head of state who did not visit since 2000. Since the reunification celebration in Bamenda and Buea, we are speaking about the head of state who did not visit that part of Cameroon. We are speaking about the head of state who did not receive nor the trade unions or the various people constituting what Cameroon has as, you know, a nation. Who can say, who can tell me tonight who is from people like Cardinal Toumi, people like Abuema Choi, who are the people that have been received by the head of state, Paul Biya? It is not a question of tribalism within the church. It is not a question of not taking in consideration the church. It is a question of a head of state who is not considering the fact that Cameroonians are important to be received at Etudi. Last time, when I was speaking about another problem concerning the minister Atanganji and the traditional rulers in the West province of Cameroon, I state about the fact that even what they call in Cameroon JICAM, the managers of companies, the head of state don't receive them at the Unity Palace. It is not a problem of church. Yes, I guess that there is a problem within the church, but it is not. I want to state very clearly that we have a problem with our head of state. The president, Paul Biya, is not considering Cameroonian as being important to be received in at Etudi Unity Palace. Okay, so I want to now speak about the world problem. You know, Abraham Kwame, rather than addressing the issues, they sent a memorandum to the head of state since 4 years. It is 4 years now that the church sent a memorandum to the head of state, Paul Biya. 4 years. 1, 2, 3, 4. And within the framework of the church, they continuously addressing the issues. They continuously addressing from the social doctrine of the church, Rerum Novarum, from the perspective of the church, from all what church has as values. You know, the church is being part of Cameroonian problem since the colonial masters installed in Cameroon. The church, with you know, the conflict between Jean Zoua and Docmo, the conflict between Thomas Mongo and Docmo, the conflict between some church, you know, ecclesiastic province in Cameroon and some of the major church person in our country. So we have to say now, I think Barrister told us about the clear and the straight point we have to address tonight. There is a too late way of addressing this issue. There is no way of don't acknowledge the fact that if today, after the major national dialogue, we are still speaking about the Anglophone problem, there is a problem, says Alain Otu. There is a problem because the main goals of the major national dialogue was to solve the Anglophone problem. And if now the Secretary of State in Vatican is coming to in our country. We don't need foreigners to solve a Cameroonian problem. We know historically what is happening, what happened in that part of our country. There is a problem of redistributing the revenues of petroleum exploitation, oil exploitation in that part of Cameroon. How can you imagine that in Mundemba, Indian division on in our country, they are exploiting SNH, Société Nationale des Hydrocarbures, the company which is dedicated to sell our kerosene, our oil abroad. There is no development in Mundemba. There is no development in Bakassi. There is no development in Bamenda. Whereas some other part of our country are benefiting from that revenues of petroleum exploitation. If we are not addressing the problem of Anglophone issues with straight talk, we will be like this too late council, English council arriving in Douala after the signature of the treaty between Douala Kings and Nastigal. So I want to say tonight that we are now obliged to appeal to the head of state, saying that we have two issues. The first is to the first is to know how Cameroonians could sit together with those who are telling us that today we want to separate. Those who are telling we want to separate are Ayuk Tabe, Fongalafo, they are in prison. Those who are saying we want federalism are Agbor Bala. Those who are saying we want federalism, we want to remain Cameroonian, they are Mancho Bibixi, they are in prison. So they have to be liberated. I want to remind Cameroonians that they announced to Cameroonians that Mr. Ayuk Tabe withdrew from prison and met with government plenipotentiary at Volie within the premises of church. What is the result of that contact? We don't know. What is the result of the contact engaged by Saint-Egidio, where Cameroonians were called upon to dialogue? What is the real result of that? So we want to know tonight that if after the aftermath of election, the aftermath of regional election, if it is not consequently addressing the issue, we have now to say, okay, the Constitution of Cameroon from 96 is no more able to solve the problem. We have to imagine another way of solving this problem by our own means.
Wendou, est-ce que aujourd'hui cette façon de faire aujourd'hui n'est pas due à ce que, parce que beaucoup pensent que l'Église catholique n'est pas complètement neutre dans cette crise anglophone?
Before I answer to that question, I want to come back to my brother on my right hand here, that he made a very dangerous general statement. You know, I keep emphasizing that the church, the universal church, the Roman Catholic Church, okay, he has an episcopal conference. And where you can talk about division is only when there is a statement coming from an episcopal conference meeting that runs contrary to the decision of the bishops of the Northwest of the Bamenda Ecclesiastical Province. Mm. And I want to tell my brother here that the same bishops, when Bishop Cornelius Fontaine Mesua was still Archbishop of Bamenda, you have the Bishop of Kumbu, his Lordship John Kuo, you have the Bishop of Boya at the time was Emmanuel Balanjo Bochiu, you have the Bishop of Kumba at the time was, that is his Lordship Agabitos Fon and Andrew Kia of Mafi. They wrote a memorandum to the head of state, and there was no there was no contrary view coming from any bishop in Cameroon per that memorandum. So I don't know from where we know the church. I believe that barristers said there that there is a canker worm in Cameroonians. We should be able to be humble and to accept what is called intellectual honesty when we want to talk. The church is not divided, so I don't think that the hate of state not receiving the bishops of Cameroon is because of division. No, you would have used this word. I'm not correcting you or putting you to morass. You would have used this word that divide and rule comes from government. They use the tactics of divide and rule, but they have not been able to divide the church, which is in Cameroon. Coming back to Serge Alain's question, I don't see, the only thing I want to tell you is that we are talking on this panel. We have never spoken about the number of priests assassinated in this country because of their stand for the common good. Because, sir, the church is not the voice of the state. You make another monumental error. The church is not the voice of the state. The church is the voice of the voiceless.
Okay.
The church is merci. The voice of the poor.
Voilà, merci. On revient après le journal parce que dans un instant, Cédric Noufélé sera là pour porter la voix de l'ensemble de la rédaction Equinoxe Télévision. Tout de suite, une passe de pub. Retour sur le plateau Equinoxe, deuxième partie, c'est le débrief du journal, toujours en compagnie du docteur Marc-Anthony Akumbon, Baristan Kamolimen. Il est là également Prince Joel Mukage et Augustine Wendou. Ce qui s'est passé cet après-midi à Bouya était prévisible. Vous êtes surpris par ce qui est arrivé?
In fact, I'm not surprised. But before I come to answer to that question, I want to finish the clarification I was making.
No, no, I'm coming. I promise.
Yes.
Let us do the brief first. Okay.
That's it. Ça m'a pas surpris parce que il y avait les combattants qui disaient que ils n'étaient pas pris en charge par le gouvernement, mais on croyait que c'était une manipulation. Aujourd'hui, cette manifestation montre que c'était vrai. Maintenant, il dit que c'est très dangereux parce qu'on a déjà arrivé à un moment que on croyait que les ex-combattants qui sont dans le centre devaient être comme un pont pour le reste qui sont encore dans le bus de sortir et venir. Mais si ils parle de malnutrition.
Pour vous, ça veut dire quoi? Ça n'encourage pas les autres à sortir?
Mais justement, I'm saying that it's not going to encourage the others. Because I don't know, somebody can go manipulate the ex-combatants to come to the street. If they have come to the street, it means that there's something wrong. Those who are managing the centers, what are they doing? Because everything they want to attribute to the president of the republic, but there are people managing the center.
Donc c'est un problème de management.
It should be a management problem. It should be a management problem. Because government cannot create such a center without the necessary means to run such a center. I believe that the treatment that was given to the ex-fighters would have been an encouraging factor to those brothers and sisters who are still in the bushes to say, oh, come on, look, these ones are integrated. They are okay. So why should I remain in the bush? But if they are talking about malnutrition and maltreatment, I'm at a loss. So me, I'm asking myself, why this? Those who are managing the centers should be taken to task, because this is very dangerous. Yeah. Cardinal Pietro Parolin had come to Cameroon with two principal messages. He is a pilgrim of peace from His Holiness Pope Francis. He carried a message of reconciliation and peace, and to reconcile a people
to reconcile uninvited people, they need to be comfortable. They need to be given a minimum of confidence. Like before I finish with this, Serge, I want to say that I watch my brother speaking there from abroad. He said foreigners should not come and solve our problems. The church, a moral personality, a church personality should not be called a foreigner, because the church is universal. The Catholic Church have a long history of enriched diplomatic mission that solve conflicts in the world.
Merci,
before I go,
promis,
I want to say, yes, excuse
parole,
me,
oui.
Before I go, my brother made a statement that I must correct, because I'm a Catholic and I'm a Catholic journalist. Let me tell you, the Catholic Church is hierarchical.
Je vous en prie, je promets vous passer la parole. On est d'abord, c'est le DDR.
Okay.
Et qu'il en soit des règles.
All right.
Je promets vous passer la parole.
I will come back.
Okay. Même quand vous avez déjà fait deux sorties de piste, j'ai tenu compte.
That's right.
Prince Joël Mukage, sur cette situation, vous êtes surpris par ce qui arrive? Est-ce que ça renvoie, c'est une bonne image que ça renvoie aux autres centres DDR? Est-ce que ça encourage ceux qui sont en brousse à...
No, to say it authoritatively, it doesn't encourage any person who is in the bush.
Qui est responsable de ce qui s'est passé aujourd'hui?
Serge, like my brother said, it's those who are managing the centers. But I believe that before we get here, you asked me a question, what I'm surprised. I'm not surprised because, first of all, there are conditions. According to the United Nations, a disarmament center is a center where two conflicting parties reach an agreement. It means that there is on one hand the government, and there is on one hand those who took up arms. The two meet together and said, okay, we want to drop arms and we want to go to a center. But when you look at the way through which the disarmament center or the commission was created in Cameroon, it was created via a presidential decree. It means the president sat in Yaoundé and said, I am creating the center. It failed within the laws of the United Nations. I'm not surprised that the guys are going wild today. Secondly, there is this aspect of the fact that disarmament search normally has got to do with that identifying the number of arms collected, showing those who have dropped their arms till date. We only hear figures when a minister, I will not call ministers' names, but when a minister is very polyvalent, the Cameroonians should know him. When he goes to Bamenda today, he tells you 10 have dropped their arms, they are in the center. When he goes to Boya, 20 have dropped their arms and they are in the center. The issue is, first, the image that Cameroon is selling every day. At times, Serge, when I look at things that are happening in Cameroon, I weep for my country. If we should live in a country where figures of the COVID-19 are inflated against an opponent team until investigations are done, before from 25 we come back to two players who have COVID-19, it is not selling Cameroon well. If we should live in a country where those who are supposed to have dropped their arms to encourage their brothers to come out. I listened to Kamwa Yani, who was heading those who dropped their arms while during the major national dialogue. I saw a young promising guy in him. I saw a repentant in him. But now, if amongst them, because he's still in Yaoundé, if amongst them, you see him coming to the street and saying, we are out because of hunger. I've gone to a dormitory school, Serge. I know what it means in the dormitory, because these guys are in a dormitory. I know what it means. If you see them coming out, it means it is accumulated anger. It's not today, it's not yesterday, right. It's not after yesterday. It is something that has been inside of them, and they said, okay, today let us tell the world that we are not feeling fine. The first question we should ask ourselves, what has become of the money, the budget allocated to the Fai Yengo Francis? Because he's the head of that commission. And once you head a commission like Fai
Yengo... Mais il n'est pas directeur du centre de...
He is the head.
Voilà.
The head of all the commissions is Fai Yengo Francis. Now there are sub-organs. What becomes of the much money? These people run into luxurious cars. Because once you're given an office, you're given a car. Now, they run in luxurious cars, why not use the money allocated? I want to be sure, Serge Alain, that even the President of the Republic will be taken aback to hear that those in a disarmament center took to the streets because they did not have food. Even he will be shocked. That is why I'm very sure that the event that has happened today, there are some heads that will roll.
There are people that will be sanctioned normally because it but normal that somebody took money that was meant to feed these people.
Sure.
Till now, Serge, we were thinking that the government should have done a kind of a report where, say, for instance, Kamwa Yanik, who has been there for long, they should have opened him a small workshop to tell those in the bush that, okay, while at the disarmament center, Kamwa Yanik, for instance, learned tailoring, and this is his shop. So that those maybe in the bushes who say, okay, why should I continue staying in the bush when one of us who used to be with us in the bush is not only in the center, but is managing his life?
Okay. Dr. Baristan Kamwa, démobilisation, désarmement, pourquoi le R fait problème? Réinsertion.
Alain, I'll start by answering a question that you ask everybody and they say...
Are you surprised, Baristan?
Yes.
What happened?
Yes, I am surprised.
Okay. Why?
Because, yes, I'm the lone person who is surprised. And I'm surprised because I underestimated the irresponsible attitude of the government. That's why I'm surprised. I'm surprised because I don't want to imagine that after people drop arms, you took these people into a center and they cannot feed. And then there is no word to describe such a behavior than saying that it is absolute irresponsibility. How do you explain it? These people, you've been chasing these people, they have been committing atrocities and they choose to repent. You take them, you create big offices, give people money to take care, and then they come out on the street to say they are not okay. One, it can push some of them back to go back.
Okay.
And secondly, it discourages every other person who wanted to come and drop arms. Alan, I thought that for once we could be serious. We made the National Dialogue a comedy show, and you appear we're doing the same with this, the people who've dropped arms. And that's why I tell you that I'm really serious because I think I underestimated the degree of irresponsibility in this country.
Okay.
It's embarrassing.
Oui, oui. Vous pouvez maintenant répondre à ma question. Pourquoi la réinsertion fait un problème? Parce qu'ils se plaignent, ils disent que depuis un an,
Alain,
il faut pour qu'ils soient
réinsertés. Alain, ça, ce n'est même pas des questions à poser. La réponse est connue. Comment tu peux expliquer même que nous qui sommes dehors, nous n'arrivons pas à avoir lumière et l'eau pendant plus de jours? L'État camerounais ne réussit pas dans ses devoirs. Ça, c'est la vérité. Ça, c'est la vérité. Il y a toujours, comment dirais-je, des visions, des choses à faire, un nombre de personnes, mais la suivi dans ces pays, est zéro. Qui suit les actions de ceux qui ont nommé? Et je vais vous dire, l'autre jour, j'ai compris qu'il y avait déjà une enquête ouverte pour le truc des rural electrification, n'est-ce pas? Who is heading it? Why is it that this same thing is happening to the same person who is heading the same corporations? Alain, the government does not have the wish, the desire to make Cameroonians comfortable. But believe me that I am embarrassed that even at that level, knowing how chaotic, how dangerous it could be if those people go back into the bushes, I feel really, 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 indeed, I'm short of words. Okay. And the head of state, and maybe the prime minister, because I think he follows up. The head of state might not be following up. The prime minister, I think he does. And he has an interest to see that something is done.
Okay.
Doctor,
sur cette affaire, est-ce que ce qui s'est passé cet après-midi à Bouya peut avoir un impact sur... Et là, c'est la crise anglophone. Surtout, le président, depuis 2018, demande à cette jeunesse-là qui a pris les armes de déposer.
Sincèrement, it can have a terrible impact. Terrible impact. Reason being that there are a lot of young people who might be because the director of the DDR who made mention that some of them were learning trade and they were being well taken care of. With those statements, people were expecting that when these young guys step out, they should show the light of what he said. But like Barrister rightly said on this platform earlier, this nation is ruled by lies. And because lies are at the top of
Est-ce qu'un problème nation. D'intendance pour ça, c'est un problème d'intendance au niveau de Bouillard. C'est l'intendance. Il se plaint du traitement qui n'est pas assez. C'est un problème d'intendance.
That is
Est-ce que ce n'est pas un problème du management du centre de Bouillard? Est-ce que ça impacte sur...
It is having... when you have a problem from the bottom, it has a trace to the top. Everything rises and falls on leadership. And so whosoever is heading that particular commission is should be the cause of the problem. If Mr. Fayungo Francis was certain that there were people learning trade, in fact, the boys in the DDR camp were learning trade, he should go there to verify, to see where the money that is released into his hands goes to, how it ends. Today they were crying of hunger. They are not well taken care of. What do you think that the next person who is sitting in the bush who was planning to lay down his arms is going to do when he hears or sees such a thing? Immediately he is going to start regretting why he was even thinking of taking that decision. And so a lot of persons who stay radical, and we will come claim that everything is fine. Everything is returning to normalcy. The war has been won by the President of the Republic. There is no reason struggling to please the President of the Republic when on the ground things are not working. If those boys could be bold to leave the DDR camp and step to the streets, it means they were ready for anything. Don't forget that.
Yes.
You want to kill them, kill them.
Mm-hmm.
I listened and I heard one of the officials said one of them should follow them. He said nobody is going anywhere. That is to make you understand how bold they are, ready for anything that comes to them. Why? They had told them that if in case you drop your arms, we are going to, they promised them the best life and we'll take care of you, help you to face life anew in the society. For years, some of them have been waiting for that. I think people like Kawa Aryanik, since 2018.
It's been there for long.
And since 2018 till now.
3 years.
He's still there. Is he not fit to enter the, shouldn't they release him? Some of them made mention that they feel like they are prisoners right now. Because that is the treatment that is given to them. They didn't tell, from what we are seeing now, it shows that they did not tell them that really that will make you prisoners.
No, vous pouvez pas dire ça.
You see,
est-ce que c'est la prison?
I am saying that the young people declared
oui.
that they feel like they are still in, they are in prison. So, from that declaration and from the fact that we understand that the DDR was created for the purpose of reintegrating them back into the society, what we are seeing does not resemble that promise that was made to them. And so, if you see them crying, I think it's to help solve the problem. And I want to pin something. What my brother Mukage said earlier, some heads will rule. But that is not what will solve the problem. It is necessary that they should go right to those camps, make sure that those boys are well treated, reintegrate some of them who have been there for long in the society so that they can be proof to others that indeed they were well taken care of. But I will tell you this, it is going to create a negative impact. Many of those who are having that idea to lay their arms will find it difficult to do it.
Okay, Augustine, d'abord,
avant
qu'on revienne sur l'Église catholique,
what beat my imagination
ouais.
is why are Cameroonians so endemic to corruption? Corruption is so endemic because you see people who had amassed wealth,
mm-hmm.
and some of them don't even know what to do with it.
yet they still pick, coins from the ground. Money destined for the management of the DTR center is coins falling on the ground. It's like crumbs from the master's table. They are still embezzling it. Because if they are not embezzled it, why should the boys go hungry? Why should they go hungry? That is my question. My question here is that Serge Alain, to solve this problem is not creating centers. To solve this problem, let the President of the Republic of Cameroon, who have received the Vatican Secretary of State with the message of peace and reconciliation, declare a ceasefire. There will be no centers. Because when you declare a ceasefire, you will contain your children. They will be taken care of. There will be terms. Because if not, you see these centers created still gives opportunity for people to swindle monies, to enrich themselves. The richer gets richer, and the poorer, keep on in plenary. It's not good. This is very, very dangerous. I am saying this. It's very, very dangerous. If these guys are on the street because they are not being taken care of, the President of the Republic should sack those who are managing the centers. In fact, and appoint those with conscience. Because I begin to ask myself, this country that had once been held as people of integrity, why have we become like people who are demonized? Vatican is coming. We should be delivered. Let Cameroonians go for conversion.
Voilà, terminez donc rapidement votre propos sur l'église.
I wanted to tell Dr. Anthony that we know the church. They don't know the church. They do not talk about the church from a philosophical point of view. The Catholic Church have the Sovereign Roman Pontiff, the Holy Father, stand unopposed. He cannot say that the Holy Father appointed a cardinal, et il y avait un groupe de prêtres, bassins, qui ont opposé. Opposé comment? Non, ce sont des mensonges. Cardinal Christian Toumi, en tant qu'évêque, n'a jamais travaillé dans la zone anglophone. Tout son épiscopal, c'est dans la zone francophone. Yagua, Garoua, Douala. Et ils sont respectés, aimés partout. Tu ne peux pas dire cela sur un plateau. On connaît l'église. Vous ne connaissez pas l'église. Quand vous voulez prononcer sur l'église, il faut faire très attention. Parce que vous prenez les individus, vous attribuez ça pour l'église. Non. S'il y a un individu dans l'église catholique qui parle de contraire, ça les engage. Mais ils ne les connaissent même pas. I don't know that individual. So the church is universal. The cardinal had never been opposed. His appointment has never been opposed. When we come, we should not mislead the public. That is what I wanted to make clear.
Okay. Oui, Barista.
Yes, I just
want to... de l'Église catholique peut faire
unanimité? I just want to make a small point of correction. I think we're being a bit too hard. He's being a bit too hard on doctor. Doctor did not say that. Did not magnify the problem the way it is. Government. The doctor said that to him that the separation amongst them could be a reason why they're not received at the presidency. That is what he said. Indeed, did not elaborate so much on the fact that, though he buttressed his fact later that when they sent this to the north, I think some people said something, but it is not that was not his intention. Now,
je peux répondre à la question. Oui, allez-y. Est-ce que cette médiation de l'Église catholique peut faire l'unanimité, c'est-à-dire des deux côtés, peut être acceptée et par le gouvernement, par le pouvoir et par les séparatistes? Surtout quand on sait que le cardinal, en novembre, les 5 et 6 novembre, je crois, a été fait captif pendant des heures par les séparatistes.
Alain, celui qui ne veut pas la réconciliation au Cameroun maintenant, c'est un diable. pour commencer. Donc, il n'y a même pas une question de savoir si ça fait l'unanimité. Oui, il n'y a même pas. Donc, ils sont venus, ça nous a dépassé de régler ces problèmes à l'interne. Et j'ai apprécié le simple fait qu'ils puissent quitter, venir pour voir comment on peut régler ces problèmes. Alain, je n'arrive pas, je ne peux pas aller dans mon village. Je ne peux pas, il y a beaucoup des anglophones, on ne fait plus. Vous comprenez? Et nous avons échoué. L'État camerounais a échoué. D'abord de laisser que ce problème soit jusqu'à ces jours. Et je vais vous dire, et je répète, c'est la responsabilité du chef de l'État lui-même de veiller à ce que la paix revient aux zones anglophones. Et je vous ai dit que pour y arriver, il faut qu'il soit humble, honnête et avoir la volonté de le faire. Et je finis en disant que la forme de cette nation doit changer pour qu'il y ait la paix. Donc, nous tous, on a besoin de cette paix.
Ok. Michel Mukage, l'Église catholique peut-elle être acceptée des deux côtés?
Sure, it's very possible. I will want to cite.
Déjà que le président n'a toujours pas reçu le clergé camerounais.
But I feel that there is a possibility for the Catholic Church to influence things. I will quote two things that the cardinal from Vatican said. One, he said, dialogue is a way out of any conflict. Dialogue. It means that even the Vatican is acknowledging the fact that what held in September to October wasn't a dialogue. Dialogue is a way out of every problem. Even in the Bible, you're going to agree with me that even when the two brothers.
Est-ce que les conflits dans le monde ont déjà été résolus après une seule rencontre, après un seul dialogue?
No. The issue today is that the Anglophone crisis is long overdue, just like Matt was saying. So it's not an issue again of talking about first or second meeting.
Voilà.
It is long overdue. And the second aspect he talked about, he said, all of us are responsible for peace, irrespective of how big or small we are. It means that where we are today, I just believe that Christian Cardinal to me, whom I respect a lot, is a father that I know personally and I used to visit. When he created or when he came up with the idea of the All Anglophone General Conference, it failed. He died a natural death. We also know that even at the level of education, we saw people like the bishops of Kumbu, George Nkwo. Nkwo trekked into the suburbs of Kumbu to encourage back to school. I believe that the Catholic Church, just like other churches, have given their all to see that the Anglophone crisis should end. Serge, the Anglophone crisis still today. Matt has said something and it's very true. There are areas in the Northwest, when I listened to one minister said that the government has won the war against terrorism, there are areas in the Northwest that they know that for you to pass that area, the separatists are the one mounting the roadblocks. If your family member dies in Douala, in Yaoundé, in other parts, for you to take them back to the Northwest or the Southwest, they know, Yaoundé knows, that you do negotiation with those boys in the villages before the cops can go and be buried. They know all those realities. Why go and tell lies? What has happened today at the disarmament center, Serge, is two messages I've taken from it. One, that people are deceiving President Paul Biya about the realities in the field. If you go and tell President Paul Biya today in Atudi that those who dropped their arms took to the streets because they could not eat, he will tell you, Chuma. If you also go and tell the president that much money that he has put, that people are using, like my brother Augustine put it, how do you explain the fact that people, because these coordinators of these centers are not new faces. When you call the name Faye Yengo Francis, those who went to primary school even in the 92s, in the 95s, know that name. It means that he must have amassed enough wealth for himself. I believe that the problem we have today in Cameroon is the fact that we keep doing what we call recycling. Nobody goes on retirement. Once they feel that you're old and you're packing out, the next day a commission is created, and here you are, they bring you back. If not, the Multiculturalism Commission is fine. It's Peter Mafanim or something. One time Prime Minister. Why keep bringing? Is it that Cameroon doesn't have
ancien directeur général de la CDC?
Why keep bringing new faces? So I believe that what has happened today should send a message to the president that those he has entrusted confidence into are betraying him. And he should also take to cognition. He should also recognize the fact that those statements that people go and end at Ayaba. I was in Bamenda in December. Those statements that people go and end at Up Station, where there is a governor's office. Leave the governor's office and just go down to Ayaba where they eat and go back to Yaoundé and say, on a gagné la guerre contre les séparatistes. Ce sont les mensonges. Voici alors la réalité. Si les gars peuvent sortir parce qu'ils n'ont pas mangé, ça te dit beaucoup de choses. Ça veut dire que peut-être quelqu'un qui est au niveau de Manfé qui dit, bon, moi je ne veux plus cette affaire, je vais sortir. Mm-hmm. Mais alors l'autre qui a déposé est en train de se plaindre parce qu'il n'a pas mangé. Quelle leçon?
Ok, merci. Merci. Rapidement, 30 secondes. Docteur, on arrive au terme de l'émission.
Mr. Sech, it is simple that I'm certain that the Cameroon government seems to be the main cause of our various crises so far. You can't deny the fact that this is a problem that we should not have been discussing here right now. It's something that would have been dealt with in 2016. But because of the same reason where Cameroonians are not respected, not to even talk of priests like we were mentioning priests, Cameroonians are not looked upon like citizens of this country. And so they are treated like dogs, some like cockroaches, some are treated, you can give the names that I've heard before. And if you have administrators who treat Cameroonians like dogs, how do you expect that a problem that was supposed to have been handled with just a discussion, amicably sitting on the table and talking, and just listening to the people, doing what they just ask. I mean, just part of the things. Lawyers and teachers, it has become a general problem. How has it come to this point? Mismanagement, disrespect of the people. If you want me to give, say things, I might say things and end up
well
in a place where I would not like. But let me be sincere.
Yes.
Cameroon government is not at all fit to solve this problem because they have tried and it's more than them.
Okay,
so
merci.
If the bishop, the bishops, the Pope can step in, it is a nice thing because I'm not looking at the Pope as from the point of the head of the Vatican. I'm looking at him as the head of the church.
Okay.
If the head of the church steps in, the head of the Roman Catholic Church steps in, I'm certain that he might be listened to.
Okay, merci. Je crois que
ça doit être un grand miracle pour ce pays. N'est pas raté encore. Pour réconcilier le Camerounais que l'Église a donné à ce pays, à le dirigeant de ce pays, il doit prendre cette opportunité et ne jamais rater ce miracle de réconcilier le Camerounais et pour qu'on vive encore comme avant.
Merci. Merci, Augustine Wendou. Thank you, Dr. Marc Anthony. Merci à vous, Prince Joël. Thank you, Barista, for coming.
C'est clair, qu'il y a certains gens qui disent les mensonges au président. Monsieur le président, ce qui s'est passé à Boya aujourd'hui, c'est clair.
Merci,
c'est quand
merci.
Le ministre dit que tu as gagné la guerre.
Merci, on vous a compris. Le président vous a déjà suivi. Hein. Vous avez même suivi quand vous parlez en anglais. Voilà. Madame, Monsieur, nous sommes donc arrivés au terme de cette édition Équinoxoir, la première de la semaine. Rendez-vous, il est pris pour demain, 19h, pour un autre numéro Équinoxoir. Bonsoir. Bokwango.